All right, 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel. Oh, what a surprise. All right. Oh, Jimmy. 2 Samuel chapter number 15. Now, remember when we were talking about these crossroads that David came to in his life, and in those crossroads were different people, and their crossroads with Samuels, where David was promoted, where David was anointed by God as king, as just a boy, a shepherd, as a significant crossroad in his life. Talked about the crossroad with Goliath. This is a make or break moment for David, a defining moment for him. He came to that battlefield that day not looking for promotion. He came to that battlefield out of obedience to his dad. He obeyed his way to greatness. That's where you are great in God's economy. You obey your way there. He didn't go looking for greatness. Greatness found him because he was in the place where he should have been. He was obeying. There was a crossroad with Goliath in it, and it changed the course of his life. Of course, God is the great mover in this situation. There's a crossroad with Saul in it, a crazy, maniacal king. I call him a maniac monarch. It's crazy. But David comes to a crossroad with this man who is in anger against David and afraid of him. Fear causes all kinds of crazy responses. And people are afraid of people. They hate them. They don't even know why they're hating them. But they hate him when you're afraid. And so Saul was afraid, and he hated David, and he tried to. Is that Richard Byer on that phone? All right. Oh, I don't have my phone. Bring your phone and put it right here. All right. I don't have my phone. Okay. He's driving to a golf course again this morning. I guarantee you, he's in North Carolina. All right. Then there's a crossroad with a Jonathan in it. I love that because Jonathan was that great friend, right? A friend that stuck closer than a brother with David. Of all of those people who followed David, for all those people, I can't put up. For all those people who followed David, we never hear about any of his brothers, really, but there was a Jonathan who was in his camp. When I not literally in his camp, but Jonathan was for David because he knew God was for David. And Jonathan was the son of the king. We could argue that Jonathan was the next on the throne, but Jonathan understood that David was really the king. And it says, symbolically, he disrobed himself and said, David, you're the man. And I know that. No sense in fighting against God, like Gamaliel said. No sense fighting against God. This is God's plan. But one of the things we said about Jonathan was that Jonathan was a friend. And remember, we talked about what a friend we know we can expect from a friend. Four things. What were they? Number one, well, I feel like such a great teacher when you all can recite this stuff off like that. We
wants you to be your best.
Right, that's exactly right about a friend. But these are four things. Affection. Right? Protection.
Correction.
Direction. That's what a good friend will offer. Right? And in chapter number 15 of 2 Samuel, David now is in perhaps the deepest point in his life. He had sinned against God, you remember that. Sinned against the Lord. The fall, and now we're getting the fallout from that. And so now David has had the kingdom taken away from him because of his son Absalom, who the Bible says was a beautiful man. The crown of his head, the bottom of his feet. He was a beautiful man. And he was attractive to the eye. He was a man absolutely lacking in character. But he was winsome, persuasive, and all of those things. And men followed him. And he stole the heart of Israel from David. And now watch, he comes into Jerusalem now as the king, and David is on the run. And I want to begin to read here, because here's a great chapter here in chapter 15. I just want to go over and cover some friends that David had. People whose names that we would not know otherwise. We read this chapter and we find out that there are some silent supporters of David, some people who, when the chips are down, came alongside David. A friend is a person who will walk in when everybody else walks out. The Bible says in Proverbs 17:17 that a friend loves at all times. A friend is a person who will stick by you when you have stunk to join up. You know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about? Stinking. You stink to join up. You've stunk it up. You've messed up. You've botched it in front of everybody. Right? Now, a friend is going to offer you the correction you need, the direction you need. Certainly, but they will stay there. And here are some men here now whose names that I want you to see. And let's get a running start. And let us look at verse number 13. And we'll just read down through the end of the chapter. Notice it says, all right, 15:13, all right? 2 Samuel 15:13. And there came a messenger to David saying, the hearts of the men of Israel are after Absalom. Our point last week was, it's so easy for our hearts to be drawn to that which is beautiful and attractive and winsome. That's just how this world is to us. The songwriter wrote, prone to wonder, Lord, I feel it. It's so easy for these old hearts to be captivated and captured with lesser things. Our loyalty is to be to the Lord, the King who sits upon the throne. And yet there are all kinds of Absaloms in this world. The world itself is an Absalom. It appeals to this old fallen nature of ours. And so our hearts can run after junk. And the men of Israel, their hearts had gone after Absalom. Absent of character and uprightness, but their hearts were after him. And David said unto his servants that were with him at Jerusalem, arise and let us run, let's flee, for we shall not else escape from Absalom. Make speed to depart, lest he overtake us suddenly and bring evil upon us and smite the city with the edge of the sword. And so David says, I'm not going to try to fight it out with him. The men of Israel have turned their hearts towards him. And so what David does is he abandons the throne and he runs for his life. There are some loyalists who are around David, and he always had those people who were around him. And those people who were sold out to David, I can imagine they scurrying around now, trying to get what little things they could gather and throw on a cart and hitch it behind a horse or a donkey, a mule, whatever, and they're going to be leaving houses and all of that because they're on the run. Because there's a crazy man, power-hungry man named Absalom, who is bound to take the throne. And here's what these kings would do. I mean, you had sons doing this to their dads. They would kill the king and everybody that was loyal to them. They would secure the power. Okay? And so David's loyal people get up and they take off. And the king's servant said unto the king, behold, thy servants are ready to do whatsoever my lord the king shall appoint. Now that's key. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that really ought to be our posture in life with our king. Amen? Amen. Oh, David is the son. I mean, Jesus is called the son of David. He's the root and the offspring of Jesse. David is Jesus is is David's greater son, and he is our king. And this ought to be our posture in life. Whatever you say, Lord, that's what we stand ready to do. So David's people are swearing allegiance to him, and that's wonderful. And by the way, I'm a pastor, I'm a church man. I love it. We have communion often at our church, and we ought to have it. You know, communion is one of those. You know what communion is? When we take communion and our hearts are right, and by the way, it's a time for you to examine yourself. Allow the Holy Spirit of God to frisk you, you know what I'm saying, and search you. Really, really, search you. Search me, know my heart, try me, know my thoughts, see if there be any wicked way in me. Right? The Bible says, I've examined myself. But you know what that is? What communion is? I said often to the people I pastor, it's a pledge of allegiance. If we come here on Friday, we pledge allegiance to the flag. When we take communion, we say, Lord, we still believe. We're showing forth his death, that's past, till he comes, that's future. But in the present, we still believe. See that? The Bible says we are showing forth his death. We're witnessing. It's a witness. Communion is a witness to a lost world that we believe. That we are in communion with him step for step. Whatever you want, whithersoever you send us, whatever you want for us, that is what we will do. Whatever you appoint. Verse 16. And the king went forth and all his household after him, and the king left 10 women, which were concubines, to keep the house, so reads the King James. And the king went forth and all the people after him and tarried in a place that was far off. Now, I don't know how many people this is with the king leaving Jerusalem, but can't you see this little pitiful, pathetic caravan? Because Absalom is coming, a man with power, and he's power hungry, and madness is in his eyes and in his heart, evil, to do evil to the king and to his loyal people, and he's on the way. And David hears about this, so they get up what they can. They move as quickly as they can. And the reason I know this was sort of an instant thing is because the Bible says in another place, and we'll read it, that David was barefoot. David didn't even have time to put his shoes on. And they take off. Now notice what it says in verse number 18. And all of his servants passed on beside him, and all the Cherethites, and all the Pelethites, and all the Gittites, 600 men which came after him from Gath passed on before the king. You remember those 600 men? Remember them? David had gone out, and there were 400 men who had followed David, who came out to David. They were debtors and discontented men. They didn't want to be under Saul. And when David was running from Saul, they went out to David. They said, we are identifying with you. Well, they were marked men because David was radioactive. And when they identified with David, they took the reproach that David had on him. They took that reproach. Then that group grew from 400 to 600 men, and these same 600 men have been loyal to David all that time. They were loyal with David. Was a king on the run. He had been anointed by Samuel a long time ago, but Saul is sitting on the throne, and God is moving David toward that throne. But when David was not lauded and applauded, when David was running and ducking spears and hiding in caves, these 600 men were right there with him. Right? Right? A friend's love at all times. That's the point. Proverbs 17:17 is a good verse to remember. Friend loves at all times. And certainly when David was coronated and became king, the Bible mentions those same 600 men came up with him. And as David ruled his kingdom, those 600 men were there loyal to David the whole time. Now David is being exiled. David is being forced out. David is being driven out. Here's these 600 men right with David. You know, you want those kinds of friends. We're with you. And now notice what it says. Then said the king, verse number 19. Then said the king to Ittai, circle that name, the Gittite. Wherefore goest thou also with me? Return to thy place and abide with the king, for thou art a stranger and also an exile. Now, I'll show you what David is saying to him. Whereas thou camest but yesterday, should I this day make thee to go up and down with us, seeing I go whither I may? Return thou and take back thy brethren. Mercy and truth be with thee. Now listen, here's a man who apparently attached himself to David when David was dwelling over there in Philistia with the Philistines. And I can't go back over all of that, but you remember David on the run from Saul, even went over into Philistines, among the Philistines, the enemies of God. But David was trying to save his life. He was in the flesh, bad decisions, but he went over there. Well, you know what? David won some friends over there, apparently, because some men came out with David. When David finally came out from there, some people came out with David. And here's one of the guys that came out with David. And so now David is on the run, and David looks around at this man, and David is basically saying to him, hey, man, listen, I appreciate you wanting to go, but listen, you don't have to do this. You're just going on back to Jerusalem. Make it easy for yourself. Take your men with you, and you're all going on back. I don't even know where I'm going. You know, you running around up and down with me. I don't even know where I'm going. I don't even know how this thing's going to pass, going to turn out. And he says to him, listen, you're a recent guy here. This is going on back. Make it easy for yourself, right? And now notice what this man says. Ittai answered the king and said, as the Lord liveth, and as my lord the king liveth, surely in what place my lord the king shall be, whether in death or life, even there also will thy servant be. Isn't that beautiful? Now, you got some people in life who will tell you, man, hey, man, what? I mean, I'm talking about when the money is rolling and everything's great and your name is, you know, everybody. I'm telling you, you got some folks tell you, man, I'm down with you like four flat tires. I'm with you. We're together, right? I'm down. But how about it when the chips are down? Now, David doesn't have a place to lay his head. He doesn't know where he's going. I mean, he's in sackcloth and ashes. He's barefoot with sand in his hair. He doesn't know where he's going. And here's this man has a chance now to go and to have an easier life. But you know what he's saying? He says, I want your reproach to be on me. I'm not interested in being friends with people who are not friends with you. But I want to tell you, that's loyalty. You know what? That's what the Lord deserves of us. Why are we so interested in having the world love us? Warming up with people who can't stand our God. Now, I'm not telling you to hate anybody, but I'm just telling you, stand with Jesus. And whoever that puts you with, then be with them. Whoever that puts you against, I guess that's who you're against. Right? But I'm standing with Jesus now. I'm telling you, sometimes standing with Jesus is going to put me against black people. Not because I'm against black people, but I'm standing with Jesus. Sometimes it'll put me with black people and put me against white people. But I'm not trying to be with or against anybody. I'm standing with Jesus. And whoever that puts me with, I guess that's who I'm with. And whoever that puts me on the wrong side of, I'm willing to be on the wrong side of, because I want to stand with Jesus. Guys, when our identity in Christ becomes the most important thing, when it becomes the major modifier, I am a Christian, then it becomes more than being black or white or male or female or American or Asian, right? I'm a Christian. That's going to put you with some people. But not because you're necessarily with them. It's because you're with Jesus. And they're with Jesus. That's going to put you against some people. Not because you necessarily want to be against people. But I'm standing with Jesus. I love this. They said, hey, look, it kind of reminds me of Ruth's speech. Y'all remember Ruth? One of the greatest speeches of loyalty was not between a man and his friend or a man and his dad or a dad and his kids. It was between a daughter-in-law and a mother-in-law. Go figure. You, I know y'all thinking, oh, blessed thought. Oh, is that kind of... That's an awesome thought. But Ruth has basically said to Naomi, where, listen, I'm with you. And where your path goes, that's the path I'm walking. Right? Whoever your people are, that's the people I'm fellowshipping with. Whoever your God is, that's the one I'm worshiping. I'm with you. See this? And I love this guy. And you won't know his name until the chips are down. You wouldn't even know this guy until now. David is having reversals, and out of the woodwork emerges Ittai. How do you say that, Mike? Help me.
Ittai,
all right? I have to go to my scholar over there for that. But I was close, all right? I always say, if you don't like the way I pronounce these words, just keep listening. I'll do it differently the next time. I'm just stabbing at it, all right? But I love this because this guy just comes right up out of the woodwork when the chips are down, and here's a friend. A friend loveth at all times. Okay. He answered the king and said, as the Lord liveth, and as the my Lord the king liveth, surely in what place my Lord the king shall be, whether in death or life, even there also will thy servant be. Now I'm going to tell you, when you throw the long ball like that, when you throw the Hail Mary, when you just say I'm all in, life simplifies. You know why life's so complicated? Because we got to decide every day whether we in or out. You know what I'm saying? I don't understand. Now, I'm again. Listen, I'm not necessarily fussing, but I'm a pastor. And I just believe God's people a lot of come to church. I don't understand y'all, some of you guys. Every Sunday, y'all got to decide whether you're going to church. That's crazy.
Amen.
I got saved 34 years ago. I made that decision 34 years ago. I don't have to make that 52 times a year. I go to church. Oh, hypocrite down at the church. There were hypocrites at the ball game tonight, but you're going. They're going to be hypocrites at the golf course, but you're going.
Call Richard to tell him that.
Hey, what I'm saying is don't use that. God never told you to believe on the hypocrite. He said believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You go to church, you know. You know why? Because, Lord, I'm with you. I'm with your people. I'm with the people who with you. All right? Not perfect people. Ittai was not perfect. David himself was not perfect. Our Lord Jesus Christ is. The people around him are not. But listen, I'm with them because they're with Jesus. Now notice this. He says, I'll be there. Now listen to what David said. And David said to Ittai, go on, pass on over. In other words, come on, guy. And Ittai the Gittite passed over, and all his men and all the little ones that were with him. I'm going to just tell you this. This is the kind of decision. It's not just this man. He's all in. You know what I'm talking about? When you get with, hey, listen, when I'm all in, guess who's going with me? My children. This old personal faith that we got that doesn't affect anybody else. Something not quite right about that. It's very, very personal. But I'm telling you, a personal faith will affect the people I come in contact with and the people I'm closest with. Your faith ought to affect your household. My faith ought to affect my household. Were y'all at the pivot the other night? Anybody at the pivot? Cam Huxford preached a message at the Pivot the other night. Did y'all, don't you? I call it a good pop in the mouth. You know what I'm saying? Men need to be popped in the mouth. This whole business of loving and having the kind of impact and influence by loving. By saying to your kids you love them. Little kids, grown kids, grandkids, your wives, saying it, writing it, expressing it, showing up for stuff. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? One of the things he said, now, it was great. He says, when a little old third grader have a band recital, you're not going because you love music. He says, it's a cat killing. It is what it sounds like. That's a great line.
That's right, Mark.
You're going because you love that child. You don't go to a little t-ball game because you love baseball. You won't see none. You go because you love these children. When you love people, you show up, right? So, you know, hey, I'm going to tell you this, and I believe that. I believe you find a good church you go to. Guys, listen. You find a good church and you show up because you love Jesus. And bring your family. You bring your little ones too. I mean, you know what I'm saying? We all go. We all go. I'm all in, guys. I'm all in. You know, let me tell you something. You find out, read the book of Exodus sometime and read how Pharaoh always negotiated with Moses. When Moses says, listen, God says, let my people go. Who is the Lord that I should obey him? You remember that? And God stopped throwing those plagues down on him. Then he calls Moses in. Hey, Moses, come here. He says, okay, who's going to go? You remember that? He said, I tell you what, you all can worship God, but you got to worship him in the land. You remember that? That's a compromise. The devil wants to offer you a compromise. You know what that's a compromise to us in? The area of salvation. Make you think you can stay in the world, stay in our sins, stay right in Egypt, and somehow worship God. Many people have fallen for that compromise. And he'll try. He says, go on and worship God. It's too right here in Egypt. No blood has to be shed. No separation, no coming out, no repentance, no nothing. Just stay right in Egypt, and you can serve God. That's a compromise. Watch this now. His second cup, Moses said, no, we got to go. We can't be sacrificing bulls and bullocks here. These people worship bulls and bullocks. You know, we can't be sacrificing their gods right in front of them. We got to go. Now watch this, what he said. He says, after a little while, he said, no, that ain't happening. After a little while, God put something else on him. He called Moses in, okay, now, you can go, but don't go far. That's another compromise, see? And we've fallen for that compromise. He'll say to you, okay, since you're going to get saved, you're going to get saved, but don't go too far. You stay right there close to Egypt. Are y'all getting what I'm saying? Don't become a fanatic with this stuff now. I mean, okay, you're saved, but you ain't got to change your language, and you don't have to, your habits, and you don't have to, I mean, just stay close to Egypt. Live right in the suburbs of sin. Live right in the suburbs of Egypt. That's a compromise. You know what his third compromise was? When Moses says, no, we got to go 3 days. We got to get out of here. We're putting this thing in the rearview mirror. We're gone, right? And by the way, that's just like in our lives. We get saved. Some of us get saved, and we want to hang out in the suburbs of Egypt. And I know that appeals to the flesh. Egypt appeals to the flesh, right? They got the garlic and the onions and the leeks and all of this, and all this is what I mean. It's a slave's life, but it's all I've known, right? We hang out next to Egypt. You're saved, but you're just saved. You're hanging out next to Egypt. You know what his next compromise was when Moses said, no, we got to get away from here? He said, well, who's going? Moses said, everybody. I love that. Everybody. Our little ones, our wives, our sons, everybody. No. Just the adults go. Compromise number three. You know, he knows that in one generation, this place is, your nation is gone. If you can go worship God and leave your kids in Egypt, y'all will never make it. You follow what I'm saying? That's another compromise. You just the adults, you men, you all go. What he's saying is leave your kids. And listen, some of us have fallen for that compromise. You know, you're saved and we're not verbally witnessing. We're not trying to bring our families along. Come to the Bible study here. You're trying to grow. Wonderful. I'm telling you, God has called us to be the leader. God has called us to say, hey, listen, my little ones come too. And listen, I'm going to tell you something. You can't make a decision for anybody as far as their love for Jesus and all of that. They're going to ultimately have to do that. But listen, you can set the direction for this family.
Amen. That's right.
By the way, let me just tell you this while we're at it. This is the last little part. The last compromise. The last compromise when he says, no, we're leaving. We're going as far as we need to go. We're taking everybody with us. You know what his last compromise was? Well, go on and go, but leave your livestock back here. Paul says, no. Not a hide, hair, horn, or hoof. He's staying back. It's all going. You know why? This is the stuff we got to sacrifice. That's a subtle compromise. You know what he said to you? You can get saved, but don't let your billfold get saved. You know how you can get saved and still be chinchy? When it comes to the Lord's work, you can get saved, but your resources stay in Egypt. I love what Moses said. Moses said, no, we got to take this stuff because this is the stuff we got to give to the Lord. This is how we worship our God. Everything we got, we put it on the altar. Hello? You know what I'm saying? That's how we worship. This is how we do it. You know? We got to take our stuff because our stuff is how we show God we love Him. We put it on the altar. He's always compromising. He's always negotiating. So we compromise as men. Don't go far. Don't take your children with you. And don't take your resources. Don't sacrifice your resources. That won't cost y'all nothing extra. Now notice this. He said, come on. He said, pass on over. You know what? This guy made such a compelling argument that David couldn't argue with him. David says, all right, you want to go? Let's go. Ittai. Now notice this. That's a great friend. Now notice this. This is a pathetic verse. This is a sad verse. And all the country, that is the people who were going with David, wept with a loud voice, and all the people passed over. And the king also himself passed over the brook Kedron. And all the people passed over toward the way of the wilderness. Now they're crying, man. This is a sad, sad, sad day. And again, some of this is the fallout from David's fall. Verse 24, we see two guys. And lo, Zadok also, circle that. There's Ittai, there's Zadok. And all the Levites were with him. Okay? Now, he was a Levite. He was from the tribe of Levi. They were the preachers. They were the ministers. They were the clergy. He's a priest. And Zadok also and all the Levites were with him, bearing the Ark of the Covenant. Y'all remember the Ark of the Covenant? You remember what we talked about it? About like a ice chest with the seraphim and the mercy seat and the, what were the items in there? Aaron's rod, a little manna, and the stone, the thing that were broken. But this was sort of like a visible identification of God's presence. You remember how David wanted to go get that ark? You remember that? The Ark of the Covenant and all that? So now, David is leaving, and so these priests, Zadok and Abiathar. All right? Notice what it says. And lo, Zadok and all the Levites were with him, bearing the Ark of the Covenant of God. And they set down the Ark of God, and Abiathar went up until all the people had gone passing out of the city. And the king said unto Zadok, this is, carry back the Ark of God into the city. Take it back. If I shall find favor in the eyes of the Lord, he will bring me again and show me both it and his habitation. But if he thus say, I have no delight in him, behold, here am I. Let him do to me as seemeth good unto him. You, even in this, you got to love the mind and the heart of David. These guys are coming out with the ark, and David looks around, and these guys bringing the ark out, the Ark of the Covenant. And I love this about David, because David says, you know what? God is not just my personal God. God is the God of this nation. I can't get God and carry him with me. He says, take it back. This is God's city. This is the place where his name dwells. This is the city of God. Take it back. I believe in God's sovereignty. If God wants me to come back, he'll bring me back. But if because of my nonsense and my foolishness, God says, I'm done with David, he's God. Isn't that good?
Amen.
I mean, God is God. And I love this about this man. He understood that he didn't have a corner on God. And he understood that God was bigger than David, and bigger than David's kingdom, and bigger than what was going on right now. He says, you take that ark on back. He was resigning himself to the fact, and I call it resigning. I say he was resting in the fact that God was God. Amen?
Amen.
And whatever God does next is right. This is the same one who wrote, yea, let God be true, but every man a liar. God is the one who is right. And if God says, hey, I want David back, then guess what? I'll come back, and I'll see this ark, and I'll see the habitation. I'll be in the city. But if God says, I'm done with David, he has botched it up, I'm done with David, he is God. I'm telling you, if Kenny Grant, if you and I, we could get this kind of a mindset in life, then life won't snap us when it doesn't go our way. You know what I'm saying? This is a spiritual elasticity where we say, hey, listen, wherever God twists this thing, I'm riding it out with God. Right? I'm not so rigid in my own ideas of how it ought to go that when it doesn't go that way, Father, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for your word. Thank you for these men. Thank you for your spirit. Teach us by your spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.